Greetings from the Iowa Beef Center. My name is Patrick Wall. I'm ISU Beef Program Specialist for Southeast Iowa, and one of my areas of interest is performance evaluation. This is a series, session one in a four-part series titled The ABCs of EPDs, and basically goes through the definitions and proper use of performance information across a wide number of breeds. Calvingies. Of course, when we talk about calvingies, we assume that we're talking about this and not this. We're trying to get cattle that come out on their own with no mechanical assistance or human assistance involved. Calves that get up and nurse and do what beef cattle are supposed to do. The traits involved, we'll first talk about birth weight. It's the historic one that everyone is used to looking at. Been very successful. There are some other traits out there that can be even more useful than that, and we'll talk about those at length. Gestation length, obviously the number of days an animal takes to get here. Calvingies direct, EPD, maternal calvingies, EPD, and then there are some other indicators that we'll discuss as well. But calvingies, obviously the major driver in profitability and cow longevity at the commercial level. So birth weight, it is expressed in pounds. At birth, usually within 24 hours of birth, it would be preferred. It's very easy to collect. The two pictures on the right, the top one is a gentleman getting the legs together so they can hoist that calf on a scale. And the lower picture is actually using a foot tape. The one in the picture individually is developed right here at Iowa State by Marshall Rubel, used as a formula to generate birth weight for submission to a breed association. And there's also some other formulas out there that folks can use. Just the important thing is to be consistent in how they're collected. It is an indicator trait for calvingies. Calvingies is obviously our goal. What that calf weighs at birth is one of the ways we measure it. But it's important that we understand that it does not account for calf shape, and that means both calf length and calf width. Head size, foot size, things of that nature. We're actually discounting calves that are long-bodied using the birth weight EPD trait only. It is adjusted up in young cows. Two-year-olds get a significant adjustment. Three-year-olds get a slightly smaller adjustment, and then mature cows are not adjusted at all. Only 60% of calf dystocia is due to birth weight. Obviously, the other 40% would be a number of other factors like malpresentations and things of that nature. It is also important that we understand that birth weight is antagonistic to other growth traits like weaning weight and yearling weight. Bigger calves at birth tend to be bigger at weaning and yearling. Gestation length. It is expressed in days, and it's not printed any longer in breed associations to my knowledge, and that's due to the fact that over-selection for gestation length actually harmed calf survivability. We need those calves to be in utero long enough so they can develop into those vital organs and hair coats and things of that nature, that when we put those calves in harsh environments, they can go ahead and thrive and survive. Again, this is an indicator trait for calvingies. It does have a high correlation, but if we're using a trait like calvingies direct, obviously shorter gestation bulls will have a better calvingies direct EPD. So we'll talk about that trait. It is expressed in a percentage of unassisted births. A lot of folks misconstrue this as it's maybe presented in pounds or something of that nature, but it's in percentage of unassisted births. And it's essentially the ability of a bull to sire calves that don't require assistance. And it is when mated to heifers only. So we only use data from heifers when we're calculating this EPD as far as a calvingies score goes. There are six scores, one unassisted, two an easy pull, three a hard pull, and that would be basically mechanical assistance or the incidence of using a calf puller. Four would be a C-section or a surgery to get the calf out the side. Five would be some sort of a malpresentation like breech, upside down, backwards. And then six would be stillborn. So there is some interpretation used in this trait. For instance, if you have a calf with the head back that has to come via C-section, that would be a calf that's recorded as a C-section and not a malpresentation, the calf's size was the reason for the malpresentation and not necessarily something that happened in utero. Birth weights are used as well in the calculation, and this is the number one tool for finding heifer bulls. If you're on the hunt for a bull to cover your heifer calves with, this would be the one to look at first. Maternal calving ease is basically one generation further from that. It is too expressed in percentage of unassisted births, and it's the ability of a bull to sire heifers that calve on their own. It's also an indirect measure of pelvic area. It's a good indicator trait of maternal ability during calving, and that's you could either term that as the athleticism of a cow, because having a calf is quite an athletic event, and it's their ability to push a calf out on their own. It can be antagonistic to calving ease direct. Be careful, I say can be, some sets of data show that this may not be the case, but logically a small heifer has a small pelvis and therefore a poor maternal calving ease EPD. And again, this is the number one tool for selecting a bull when you're planning on keeping daughters or making replacements. This graph here comes to us from the Simmental Sire Summer, and I just want to draw your attention to two different numbers. The correlation between birth weight and calving ease. You can see it's very negative. As birth weight goes up in pounds, calving ease direct goes the opposite direction. But on the contrary, weaning weight and birth weight have a positive correlation of about the same level on the other side as zero. So if we're selecting against birth weight, we're also selecting against weaning weight, which can be contrary to what we want our cattle to do. So the calving ease direct would be the number one trait to look at. Other indicators we can use would be phenotype, head size, shoulder size, how the animal is shaped, foot size, bone structure, things of that nature. We can also use measures of yearling weight and mature size. Big cattle at the end tend to be big at the beginning. And then also our bull breed or our source of genetics that we get. The picture in the upper right would be a very poor selection for use on heifers based on phenotype. Also EPD accuracy. If we use a lot of unproven bulls, basically yearlings, we're not necessarily using something that we have a lot of confidence in. So that's why a lot of operations consider artificial insemination on heifers. We have a little better idea of how those bulls are going to work. So in summary, some breeds no longer print birth weight EPD because calving ease direct is a better indicator. It is the trait of interest, and if you're going to search for heifer bulls, I would try to keep them in the top 25 to 30% for calving ease direct EPD, maybe even better than that. Use high accuracy sires when possible. As mentioned, an AI program might be one way to do that, and be mindful of antagonistic traits. I'll end with this. There's as much variation within a breed as there is between breeds, so don't forget about heterosis. It's the only free lunch we get in the cattle business. So getting those calves on the ground is good, but we also get that free lunch if we use a bull that offers some heterosis. So hopefully those traits help us get calving ease in the right direction, both at the female level and within our maternal cow herd.